It's Thursday night at 8 p.m. and you know what that means. We talk uncut. This is the Xbox Uncut Weekly Podcast.
Should I cover my body in various Oreos to get chicks?
Yes.
That's Dustin. They don't call him Xbox Uncut's muscle for nothing.
You need to treat yourself every now and again.
Steve rules. More like Steve makes the ladies drool.
You can take it off and you can give it to your lady.
That's Vern. They call him the golden throat.
I'm triggered. So triggered right now, man.
Better watch out, ladies. Jason's a poster out of control.
One that I went crazy when it came out, and I literally ate like three bags of them.
Eric may be the quick look guru, but ladies, he ain't quick.
And then you get like loads of milk and like funnel it in.
If you throw some Fruit Loops in there, I've seen this porno.
Yeah, that works for you people who live, you know, across the ocean, where you can actually control your urges and stuff.
Hey, baby, you want some pumpkin spice?
I'm sitting up. You have my full attention.
Can we call this Oreo and cut from now on?
Welcome to Xbox Uncut's Weekly Podcast. I'm your host, Dustin. This is another crazy week of video game news. I would just like to thank One Saint for that amazing intro. So awesome. So good. We needed a porno intro, and we got it.
It really sets the mood.
Yeah. I got those pumpkin spice Oreos on layaway. I can't wait. But
I just had some today, actually.
Oh, did you? Were they good?
I think yeah. I don't have any.
Nope. We're on a different diet now. I'm doing really good on it.
Is it the Oreo diet?
Yeah, totally.
Oreo diet. It's supported by diabetes.
They were really good today. I was kind of upset with them because they didn't take the milk very well today. They didn't get soggy like they did last year when I had them. So
Darth Vader says that intro needs a mustache, and it does. I think that's what the picture of our. We need to find a good mustache for the photo.
Porn for stash. Show.
A porn stash. Yeah, it has to be. Maybe handlebars. I don't know. It's gonna be awesome though. But I'd like to thank everybody for joining us this week. This is going to be it for the podcast. That's all we had was the intro, because nothing else happened this week.
No, nothing at all.
Nothing. All right, well, peace out, everybody.
We're not going to talk about the PS4 price drop.
Oh, you know what? We got Drive Club news. We got PS4 price drops. We got, man, the PlayStation podcast, part of our podcast, is going to be fucking amazing this week. Forgot all about it.
It's just Dustin that, you know... You talk about Drive Club, but you don't want to talk about the biggest thing that could have happened that would drive Drive Club sales through the roof. Like, literally through the roof.
It's true.
Come on, where's the dedication?
Taking away PlayStation Plus edition?
Look, the PlayStation Plus version was offered. They've always said it was going to be a limited time. It was never guaranteed for the life of PlayStation. Like, it was just literally, hey.
That is true.
Have a PlayStation Plus version.
To be fair, that is true.
But after all the shit that game went through.
You know what? But they're, you know, unlike Microsoft, Sony is true to their word. Okay? They said limited, and they made that bitch limited. So, Drive Club PlayStation
By that word, you mean greatness awaits?
Yes.
Oh, come on. Let's talk about Xbox.
Greatness has cometh and passed.
Oh, this is a PlayStation fuck.
Let's just introduce everybody.
Xbox.
Steve Rules. Welcome to the show, Steve. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me, Dustin. Good to be here. Hello, listeners and friends.
Friends.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
Wow, friends
that's
a strong nice. Word.
Yeah. Yeah, I wasn't talking about you.
Yeah, I was supposed to say acquaintance is like a better term, but his mom might be watching, you know?
Colleague?
We haven't reached the level of mates yet, so.
Yeah.
Dustin's a good guy, you know, Tim's a good guy, and, you know, Jason's all right. And
everyone wants to be me.
I want to be Timcat.
I'm slightly paragon. Vern's completely paragon right here.
I do not want to live in a world where with someone who doesn't like stealth games.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But let's go right over to Vern. How are you doing this week, Vern?
Good. I had Oreos, so I'm feeling good, man. Pumpkin feeling really spice. Good.
Yeah.
Had the week off last week. Wasn't really a week off, though. It was a pretty busy week, so.
Yeah.
But I'm all refreshed, ready to go. Talk about some Xbox.
Steve Rules is a real bro. Help me out with Pumped BMX Plus. Oh, Steve's trying to make friends with Wicked. It's so, so nice. It's touching.
We had a good time chatting about that.
Yeah. Who plays a game like that called Pumped BMX Plus?
That would be Steve Rules.
It's like the kind of game you play if you get it for free.
No, I paid for it. It was really good. I got all the achievements.
Really? What kind of game is it?
It's like a 2D game of the bike, and you have to do like skills and get scores and do tricks and stuff.
So it's like Excitebike.
Possibly. It's like Trials, only... Yeah.
Well, I would ask everybody to check out steverules.com to learn more about Steve and the crazy games he plays. Because it's Steve. We love Steve.
And even if he doesn't love us.
Yeah.
But no, I did qualify that it was just many just you.
Just
I don't
you,
yeah.
We also have Jason. Welcome to the show, Jason.
Well, I'm pumped. Microsoft,
PlayStation news. Yeah, we're going to talk about past PlayStation exclusives.
That's right.
We also have Tim Dog.
Welcome to the show. Yeah.
Tim, how are you doing this week, Tim?
Doing good. A little tired. Been a bit sick, but I feel like I'm getting it off of it finally. That's why I'm not on camera today. I just look like crap.
Yeah. I thought it was the beating you took from Timcat on Twitter.
That dude's brutal.
I'm about to block him. He just doesn't stop. He was nice the one day. And
look, you know, sometimes trolls just lash out, you know?
He really, really has it out for me, though.
You just have to learn to ignore them.
Yeah.
And when I say that, I mean most people on this podcast.
You have to fight trolls head on. You can't ignore them. That makes them think they've won. You have to fight them, Tim. Get in the trenches. Grow a big gorilla.
I agree. But I just, like I said, I've been... Timcat knows probably that I'm a little down. So he attacked me today, and he
got to
really,
kick him while they're down, man. That's the easiest time.
He really got me.
You just sound so convincing with that.
Well, he tweeted me 800 times, so I guess I know how people feel when I usually go after them.
Yeah, my Twitter feed ended up every other post with Timcat yelling at Tim Dog. I was like, yeah, why not? It was awesome, though. I read them all.
All right.
Bruiser Bear, a free copy of Drive Club is still overpriced, in my opinion. Good for you, Bruiser Bear.
On to Twitter, Warrior.
We're lining up Warriors for the Xbox Uncut Army.
An army, yeah.
All right. Steve. Steve.
Yeah.
You there, Steve.
I'm here.
What are the releases? We're going straight to releases, man. I need to know what's coming out. Are you even ready? I didn't even ask you if you were ready. I have no idea, Steve. I'm trying to delay this so you can get a sheet up.
I am ready, Dustin. I looked at the clock. It was about 12:30. And I was like, you know what? I need to do releases. I need to be ready for when Dustin calls upon me. So here we go. This evening... Afro Samurai 2 Episode 1, the game that is apparently incredibly offensive.
Really?
Kaiju Panic. Yeah, they said it apparently it's terrible and offensive. So
what's offensive about it? Did you hear anything?
I think it's just like stereotypical and
curse words in it.
Yeah, I don't know, just like the way that it sort of represents certain groups. And yeah, and I think GameSpot gave it an absolute hammering. So anyway, so is that the Kaiju Panic, which is like a strategy tower defense game, is coming out this evening. That I was actually, when I was looking at that, surprised that it actually looks quite fun. So that might be
it's really cheap too.
Is it?
Yeah, I think it was like $4 or $5 or something cheap like that.
I might pay that up then. Three-fourths home, which admittedly I wasn't quite sure what it was.
Three-fourths, as in there's a fraction in the title of the name?
Well, it's just sort of written. I think it's like a sort of one of these sort of arty sort of experience games. I think it's also only going to be $5, so...
It's one of those real-time turn-based games.
Okay, Steve, I got a question.
Wait, should they convert it for the European market so it's not in standard? Does it need to be a metric?
Okay, on the 12th, we have Back to the Future 30th Anniversary Edition from Telltale.
$20, right, for everything? If I remember right.
I think so, yep. And that's at retail.
I've never played that one. I'm tempted.
It's pretty good. It's more like the older Telltale games, so it isn't kind of... It isn't like Walking Dead, where there really aren't any puzzles. There's actual puzzles in this game, so it's closer to like what you see in Sam & Max and the Wallace and Gromit and... what's the other one?
Jurassic World Park?
No, the Jurassic Park game is more like Walking Dead, but this is more like Monkey Island. That's another one that's like...
Shame the Jurassic Park game was just utter shit, really, wasn't it? There's the Wasteland 2, which is a sort of turn-based RPG, top-down, isometric. I think that looks really good, actually.
Got good reviews on PC, too.
Yeah, and they said that they thought that people would be really surprised about how well it translated to controller. So if I can complete a couple more games before Tuesday, I'm very tempted to pick that up. Then there's Minecraft Story Mode Episode 1 finally coming out. Then on the 14th, we have Crimson Land, which is like a twin stick shooter. And you can play it local co-op as well. Goosebumps, even. Which is there a film coming out or something?
Yes. It's based on the thing. It's based on the old books. Who wrote that? R.L. Stein or something like that?
Yeah.
But Jack Black's in a movie version of it. No, the game's based on that or something. I don't know.
Yes, it all sounds atrocious and the game sounds terrible as well.
Yeah.
Then something called Laser Life, which I think it's you in like space or something. I honestly tell you, I did watch a trailer of it and at the end I was like, what the fuck is this? And then,
for anyone who wanted to live the life of a laser, this is the game for you.
Yeah. Remember what it means to be human in this interactive biography of a dead astronaut found in deep space by future intelligences who have no concept of humankind. It's probably going to be about $15. Have fun with that. And then next Friday, the final one, I believe, is Rock and Racing Off-Road DX, which is like a top-down cooperative little racing game. So... That's it for releases. Big week, actually.
It's awesome. A ton of ID at Xbox stuff coming out over the last month.
I don't give a damn about any of that. I'm just waiting for Halo.
Me too.
Yeah.
15.5. All right.
Maybe I'll get that one game.
Which one?
Wasteland 2. Oh. I heard good things about that.
Do you like turn-based RPGs? Because that's what
sometimes
it is.
I played them when I was kids. I used to like them, but I might give that a try. I kind of like the concept.
I think it's like $40 or something, or 30. Wow. So it's quite expensive. But as I said, it's supposed to be really good. So
is that on PS4 now, or is this like an older?
Yes, it's going to be.
Yeah, it's out on both the same day.
It's on the superior system known as the PS4. Yes, that's right. Well, Vern, I hear we had letters this week.
We did.
And I've got good news about letters, too. It's not just email at xboxuncut.com. I remade it. We're back to letters at xboxuncut.com.
Yay! Why? Because
I hated saying email at xboxuncut.
It sounds really dumb. Right.
But there's not there wasn't a better way for me to put it. I kept trying to think of words, and I was like, that doesn't sound right.
You're not very good at that.
Yeah.
Love letters at Xbox.
Yeah, I could have done. I should have done love letters at Xbox. That actually might
correspondence at xboxuncut.com.
But Yeah, I wanted... We're switching back to letters at xboxuncut.com because all the spam websites went, well, it doesn't exist no more, so they unsubscribed us. So we're not getting spam. Yay.
But, oh, that's good.
If we start getting spam again, I'm going to delete it and we'll go back to...
What about warriors at xboxuncut.com?
Maybe. Yeah. We'll think about
it. If you want to send in a console warrior email, I think that works.
Yeah.
But I don't know that right now, so that will not work. So remember, letters at xboxuncut.com.
Or and romance at xboxuncut.com.
Yeah, we have four letters. And we also have a tweet, too. I'll start with that, because this came earlier in the week. This is from 07 Deadly Sins, who follows us on Twitter. He wrote, podcast question. What are Xbox Uncut's views on the Microsoft acquisition of Havoc? And why is the media not reporting on it? Great podcast.
We're going to talk about Havoc later on.
All right. That'll be part of the news, so we'll get to that later.
I
want to
talk about it right now. Havoc is a great purchase, and not a lot of people are talking about it because they're still going to do the deals with every other company. Pretty much that's it. Yeah. They're not.
No, there's discussion on it.
Havoc's not
going
to go away on PlayStation. Like, it's
no,
like,
of course, but there's definitely a conversation on whether... on the effects it's going to have for Azure and so on and so forth.
No, that's true, but it's not going to, like, it doesn't...
No, of course not. That's
no,
a silly...
No, but I'm sort of saying that's why it's not being talked about in the same scope. Like, if Microsoft bought Havoc and then said, well, that shit ain't going to PlayStation, it's not going to Nintendo, it's going to be ours only, that would have been bigger news. But this is like, hey, everything's going to stay the same how it was, we're just buying them so we own them.
Well, for people who don't know, though, Havoc is a physics engine, right?
It's not just a physics engine. It's also AI, destruction. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different...
But a lot of games use this. Uncharted uses this. Yes. Grand Theft Auto uses this. It's Destiny, one of the most commonly used... Halo.
Like, Uncharted, Smash, I think, uses... Right. Uncharted uses Havoc Destruction, and
right.
Havoc something else, and other games. Like, not all these games just use Havoc physics. Like, some... I think one of them uses Havoc cloth.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Yeah. So I mean, it's going to be fucking hilarious when you see Microsoft logos all over everybody's game, no matter what system it is.
You probably won't. They'll just
probably
leave Havoc. Yeah.
It would be funny if it said Havoc and then a Microsoft company right under it.
Havoc.
I think what he's talking about, too, is why isn't it a big deal?
Well,
but it is a big deal, and I quite frankly don't know why it wasn't talked about as
it's
I thought it should.
It's not a controversial deal, I should say.
Right. It's not going to affect Sony really in any way. It's not going to affect Nintendo.
I guess.
You know?
Yeah.
They'll still license it. They're going to. It's just. It's Havoc. It's what everybody uses because it's
the
cheaper,
important
to,
part
it's
behind...
cheaper to license Havoc than it is to hire a team to build the physics engine for your game because Havoc just does it for you.
And well, now Microsoft will make that money.
It's also important to note that Havoc can be used more than just gaming for Microsoft. They can also use it for the 3D rendering that they do for business partners and stuff like that.
It'd be like Microsoft going, we'll never use Blu-ray because there's a chance that Sony will get some of the profit. That's not how companies work.
Well, this has to help with Crackdown as well, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Specifically labeled Crackdown as a...
Azure, like, all this is going straight to Azure. Like, all the Havoc stuff. It just makes too much sense.
It makes DirectX 12 more appealing. But, moving...
I think DirectX 12 will get native support for Havoc, and that's pretty good.
All right, well, I'll get to the first letter now. Let's see. This letter is from... I don't want to say the person's name. I'll say the gamer tag. Botterham Zach. It's B-O-T-E-R Ham Zach.
Are you sure that's
so
not a game that's getting released?
I don't know. I'm gonna call him Butterham. This is from Butterham. Butterham says, what, Steve?
Another week, another name that's been butchered by Van.
Sometimes you just gotta butcher it.
All right. Well, Butterham says, hi, guys. After listening to you guys for a long time, I really want to get something off of my chest. After playing the Need for Speed closed beta for a few hours, I am really, really disappointed with the handling of the game. I play Forza with all assists off and the AI on expert, and in Need for Speed, I can't even win the first race because of the floaty controls. I was really hoping this would be fixed in the reboot. Am I the only one that feels this way, or do you guys agree with me about the floaty weird controls in the Need for Speed series? Just to be clear, I really love the rest of the game with the live-action cutscenes and the whole street racing setting. Keep up the great work, and I would love it if Steve starts right after this question with, "The thing is..." Thanks, guys. By the way, hit me up on Xbox Live. My gamer tag is BotcherHamZack. And then, what does GR period stand for, if you're in the Netherlands?
Grr.
Okay. Well, he wrote this as Grr, Martin Schulten from the Netherlands.
The thing is...
Wait. Shut up, Jason.
The thing is... I haven't played Need for Speed. I feel bad. I wish I had now.
Has anyone played the beta?
Eric did.
Oh.
Eric, how do you feel about it?
Is Eric in here?
No, he's not. But it works the same. Well, I think everybody will tell you. I think everybody in this room will agree. Forge has spoiled everybody on racing games because the handling's really fucking good and... Horizon's really good, and Forza Motorsport 6 is really good, and Horizon 2 is really good. Like, there's just... We want Forza's physics in every racing game.
I think it's not just... It's like the difference between a bad shooter and a good shooter. Like, a shooter like Battlefield feels good, but, like, a random off-the-shelf bullshit shooter feels awful. And it just doesn't feel like games like Need for Speed put as much attention into the driving model as companies like Forza do, or Turn 10. Because the same thing can be said about the crew. The crew also has awful driving physics.
Yeah, but the Burnout Paradise? That didn't have awful handling, and that's the same...
But it wasn't...
Right?
Yeah,
no, but I think there's a paradigm shift. I think if you look at it, like, there were third-person shooters before Gears of War, like cover-based shooters. They existed. And then Gears of War came out, and everybody went, "Wow, that's how you fucking do a third-person cover-based shooter." And everybody has to turn that way. And Forza kind of, like Horizon 2, kind of did that for open-world racing games. Where, mm-hmm. I mean, the original Horizon was amazing. It didn't reach as many people as I think they wanted it to. But now that, like, Horizon 2 did its thing, and then they had the Fast and the Furious version of it and all that... You got all these people that are playing Horizon 2 going, "Wow, that's how you do in an open world racing game. That feels right. That feels like me driving a car." And you get spoiled, it'll only progress racing games to be more like that, where they feel like you're actually driving.
Well, but Forza Horizon 2, it still feels kind of arcadey at the same time. They did a good job at bringing the Forza physics model to an open world game
I'm not saying
arcade
it's super
thing.
Realistic.
Yeah,
it's good enough where it feels like you're driving a car and not like you're playing with a controller controlling your car on a screen.
I think Dusty's right when he says we've been spoiled, because I think the way Forza does their physics is the huge difference here. Like, Forza doesn't program in 0-60 numbers. They don't program in how tight a car can turn and how much traction a car has. They don't do any of that. But what they do is they put these statistics into their physics engine and they let their physics engine work it out for itself. Mm-hmm. So you're not just feeling, "Oh, this car's been programmed to run this fast." You're feeling a car that is running that fast because that's what it does in the physics engine. And that's the problem you have with some of these games that have, like, drifting mode and shit like that, where the entire physics engine has to be changed to allow you to drive a certain way. And I don't know, man. I haven't played it yet. Everything I've heard about the physics on Need for Speed has been pretty negative.
I think games like Forza Horizon 2 push other games. I mean, yes, you're going to have shitty games for a couple, like a year or two, but it'll push other racers to get better, to be better. And we'll just see if they'll progress. And, we will move out of having games that are just awful. Like when Halo originally came out, it made first-person shooter controls on console. Like, that's how you do it. That's how we're going to do it from now on, and everybody's copied it. And that's exactly what's going to... It happened with Call of Duty. It's going to happen with racing games. It's just you have that defining game, and that's just how it works. I mean...
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see.
I honestly do. And I don't... I'm not trying to say Forza is the only game you'll ever want to play. It's just...
It takes to catch up. As a guy that likes racing games, Forza is literally the only game this generation that I can even recommend that's racing. Like, Project Cars runs like shit on console. I'm sorry. It just does. It doesn't matter if it's PS4 or Xbox One. That game runs
Been improved quite a lot for
it
PS4
has,
especially.
But I played after the update, and just me, just one car on track, and I streamed it so Eric could see the same thing. One car on track, I'm just driving around. Audio glitches constantly through the entire thing. Like, the Glidio is bugging in and out through the entire thing. And this was a couple weeks ago. The frame rate and tearing was constant. Like, it was going down. It almost felt like 20 frames, almost less than 20 frames per second. And this is just one car on track in day. Fixed time of day. Like, it wasn't anything demanding. And... You know, the problem is you go to Forza and you can expect a certain level of performance and it's always going to be like that, you know? You don't have to worry about, oh, if I race in these kinds of settings where the game's going to run like shit. I shouldn't have to worry about that.
Yeah.
No, I don't think it was about running. I just think the physics are really good in Forza and other games will improve on their physics to get a similar feel and it'll improve all racing games.
Yeah.
High tides raise all ships. That's all I'm saying. High tides raise all ships. All right. We got to be racing games. It's going to
be
awesome.
Go ahead, Steve.
Video
games. What were you
going to
say?
I was just... the thing is, I'm not much of a Need for Speed player, but I do feel like perhaps that franchise has been a bit of a strange position when they made the studio in Sweden and then they got Criterion to start doing it. And then they were like, oh, actually, this year we're going to take a year off, which was last year, which it didn't sound like was originally the plan. I feel like they don't really know what to do with it. So... And the heads of Criterion left as well. So I don't know whether that's perhaps affecting them or not.
Probably has.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, anyway, thanks for writing in, Butterham.
Butterham.
Butterham. Is it like Caterham?
I'm so sorry.
Butterham.
You know, he's insulting you.
Shame on you, man. Dude, this is like, this is how it goes, man. It's a rite of passage for people who write into the show.
Yeah.
I gotta mess up their names. All right, this next one is from Special Ed. We know him from Xbox Live, yeah. One of our Aussie friends. He says, "G'day, guys. Jason got me onto the show, and I'm thoroughly enjoying it. Makes the drive home from work more bearable. Keep it up. Jason and I had spoken about even being on, but as an Aussie, the time zone difference could make it tricky. Anywho, the question I wanted to ask is, how would you guys feel about a one-console future? And to further that, in this hypothetical future, who is doing what? I envision a console built designed by Sony with input from Microsoft and Nintendo. An OS built by Microsoft with existing Azure Live infrastructure with the combined first-party output of all three. As a multi-console owner, I'm getting pretty tired of constantly buying so many consoles and trying to split what little time I have. But I refuse to miss out on any great games like I did as a kid being a hardcore Sega fanboy. Mario Kart 64 showed me the way. Your friend from the ass end of the world, Special Ed."
All I want to say is I don't think it'll be Sony or Microsoft or Nintendo making this one console future. It'll be AMD. If they're still a company. No, I'm being dead serious. They'll just say, fuck it. And then they'll go, hey, Microsoft, Sony, just license all your stuff to our console. We'll build it. It's our product. Unless Microsoft buys AMD, then maybe it's Microsoft. But, yeah, just, you know, that's how I see it. I think it's
but throwing
NVIDIA
that out
AMD.
Of the window... If you could make the ultimate console combined from these companies, what would it be? That's kind of what, at least what I got from the email.
If it could be like the Surface Book, I want Microsoft to make it.
See, that's what I was thinking too. He was saying it would be cool if Sony built designed it, but after I saw the Surface Book, it's got me thinking that they got some really good hardware designers
talk about
at Microsoft
that later
now.
Too. Yeah, we're
so,
gonna talk. Yeah.
That was pretty impressive. So,
I know that we'll probably get onto this later. I was wondering though if perhaps. They will get the Surface team to make to design the shell at least to the next Xbox. Maybe finally we could get one that looks
Well, what nice. I can tell you, Steve, is that apparently the Lumia team, the guys making the 950 and 950 XL right now, are a separate team. But apparently in the next year or so, it's all going to be one team. So the Surface team, the Lumia team, they're all going to be making hardware together. And I'm going to guess that team's probably going to build the Xbox.
They're going to build something badass, too.
Yeah. I think they're going to build the Surface phone. That's
so what we're saying.
Yeah.
Is
oh, yeah.
That's the first thing. I don't know.
Microsoft console with Microsoft online infrastructure with Microsoft
games.
First party. Yes.
Yeah.
And Sony could take their couple games that they've released.
They could bring them to Xbox.
They could bring them to Xbox. They could send out Bloodborne and then Uncharted 4. That's their full two games this whole year,
right? That's good. And they can bring Mario Kart out on Xbox, you know, from Nintendo. You know, we'll take that.
Does this mean I could finally play The Last of Us with a non-shit controller?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Look, so we all decided. Let's be a little fair. The DualShock 4 is not complete shit.
No, yeah,
we just want Microsoft to buy out Nintendo and Sony and take all their IPs and everything, right?
Yeah, it'll be like how like XM and Sirius merged because it's not a market that's big enough for multiple people, so they'll just buy Sony and Nintendo. Makes sense, right?
Yeah, and they'll call it Ultimate Box instead of.
I do not want a single console feature. I definitely like competition, so I'm not for that one. I think we'll get there eventually because of PCs. And everything's going to be on PC at some point, but I do not support a one console future whatsoever.
Yeah. Me either.
There's going to be the people that shift to mobile and the people that, you know, just resist that completely and all meet together on PC, right?
Look, when the Facebook video game console comes out and becomes the only console, y'all are all going to regret this because the Oculus Rift is going to be the de facto console in the future.
But I always have this idea.
I have this idea
that, you know, all this console warrior stuff's going to go away because we're all going to be best friends because we'll be fighting on to whatever we have left, and that's going to be hardcore games on PC someday.
Do you also believe in unicorns?
Yes.
No.
I believe in winged horses that fly profits to the sky.
I think the biggest problem with a single console feature is justifying the variation of games that you would have on it. Don't you think? Like, if you had Forza, Gran Turismo, Project Cars, like, at some point, it would be like, that's a lot of simulation racing games. But, I don't, and not to mention a set of Corsa by then, and so much else, and think of all the suitors. I almost
We'd have less
say,
games.
There would be less games. Especially big games.
All right, well, I think that's the one constant future discussion. Any more letters? Anymore.
Oh, yeah, we got two more, but thank you for writing in, Special Ed.
Thank you.
Now, this one is from one of our favorite writers, listeners, The Wicked Soul. The Wicked Soul says, this is one question that's been rolling around in my mind. Do you guys think it's healthy to repress your emotions for extended periods of time?
Yes, and this is why. If you have Oreos in your life with milk, you can just suppress any emotion you need to.
Okay,
it's
listen.
Okay.
Wicked, listen to me. One, this is trash. Two, that was in reference to a Twitter thing. Two, just masturbate. You'll be fine.
What?
Stop holding in your emotions. Go knock one out and move on with your life.
Well, I think he's very happy. Wicked's happy because now all day breakfast has come from McDonald's, so
that's
Wicked,
really important.
Wicked, if he was holding some type of anger, that breakfast and having a sausage McMuffin at 3 o'clock in the day.
Yeah, look, we're thinking me and Tim are on the same page. 3 p.m. egg McMuffin,
followed by a McFlurry. I mean, come on, that's amazing. You can have both at the same time.
I would.
Preceded by a flurry in the pants, but
and then you can have a cheeseburger like as dessert. Come on,
with pancakes.
Yeah, you can make a pancake burger. You can say I'm gonna order this quarter pounder, and I'm gonna order the what's the pancake sausage thing? McGriddle.
Jacks.
The McGriddle. The McGriddle. Yeah, then you'll take the McGriddle pancake parts off and put that around the hamburger.
Put
and
it
you got
in a sesame seed bun. I mean, this is brilliant.
And when you can do whatever you want.
And when you start crying, just go to Rally's and get a funnel cake.
Yes.
Rally's has funnel cakes?
Yes, they do.
I didn't know Rally's had funnel cakes. Where? What the fuck?
Rally's funnel cakes.
I love a funnel cake, and I love funnel cakes. And I never thought.
Don't get too excited. They taste like chicken.
Are they fried in the same grease or something?
Of course. Yeah. So what does this funnel cake taste like? Tastes like chicken. Fish. It tastes like fish. It tastes like everything except for flour. But it's a funnel cake.
And
what if you get it like right when they open? Maybe it would be okay, right?
It'd probably be pretty solid, man. Pretty solid.
Yeah. Probably, yeah. And then your chicken would taste like a funnel cake instead.
And then go on a time machine and go get a churro from Taco Bell.
You're blowing my mind, Vern. You're blowing my mind. Funnel cake flavored chicken wings? Oh my god.
But anyway.
Wicked
emotions.
Wait. There's an emotion we need to talk about. Who was it? Mickey Worm? Mickey Worm has never had an Oreo. Miggy, I need you to send your address. I will send you a box of Double Stuffs.
Mickey, how is that possible?
Double Stuff?
We do have Double Stuff over here. Actually, we have peanut butter over here now because Dad brought some home the other day.
Peanut butter.
I think we need butter ham Oreos, personally.
Did you have any bananas?
I fucking hate all of you.
You can have a peanut butter and banana salad with some Oreos.
I think we gotta get back to the question. Do we think it's healthy to repress emotions? I would say
no.
No, it's not. It's not healthy. You need a friend who you can get these emotions out.
I honestly just have McDonald's at 3 o'clock.
Me and Tim, it's same page. Flapjacks.
I think what Tim is trying to say.
I just think that's just. And a Butterfinger too. If you can follow up that with a Butterfinger, and I think Wicked will understand. There's no reason to be not happy.
There's not an emotional problem that diabetes can't cure.
I think what they're trying to say is find the one thing in your life that helps you deal with stress.
True to yourself.
And that's diabetes.
And don't fucking listen to these guys.
And play video games.
No, honestly, like
no,
if you
no,
feel like
these are all bad ideas. Go find a friend.
No, I'm gonna hold. I'm gonna just I
know you're gonna hold. Breakfast. Look, off the podcast, me and you can go get some McDonald's breakfast at 3 p.m. But for anybody listening, if
he says he'll make love to Ronald McDonald. You're going it too far. You're going too far.
Hey, if Ronald McDonald will give you a hand job or something, go for it.
Okay, here's what you do. Here's what you do, Wicked. Go have that McDonald's breakfast and go up to the statue of Ronald McDonald and give him a hug. All right? Just give him a hug. Don't kiss him and walk out.
You could, if you really want to let that anger out because of the years that they didn't have this breakfast. You know, because I know you were angry about it. You know, you know, we talked about it on Twitter. You know, you can let that Ronald McDonald. You should let him have it.
Hit him.
I think Wicked Souls should go ahead and get a puppy. Take care of that puppy.
Yeah,
love that puppy.
Good.
Do not feed the puppy
Pet
at
that
McDonald's
puppy.
Breakfast.
Yeah.
Don't feed it. Don't feed it McDonald's. Save McDonald's for you.
What? Sharon is caring.
Yeah,
sharing is caring.
So it kills your dog. Yeah,
you're not supposed to give them a McRib, okay?
You might be feeding
God.
Them like their own kind, possibly.
Tim,
who knows?
I'm thinking about getting a McRib and like a sausage biscuit at the same time.
I think McRib is. I can't find a McRib. I actually want
a
McRib.
They haven't done it yet. So like a McRib, I got to find out what breakfast menu item goes with the McRib.
All right, we got a lot to talk about, guys.
Maybe the hash brown?
Well,
we got to move on. Last letter. Last letter, right?
Sorry, Wicked.
It's the last letter. Sorry. But yeah, Wicked, don't repress.
My best bro is a doggy. Good for you, Wicked.
Hey.
Good for
you. There you go. This last letter is from Shola. Shola writes, "Hi, guys. Forgive me for the multi-topic email." Okay.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's no forgiving necessary. We love multi-topic emails.
Except when they're written by Steve. Damn.
Hey, you told me I wasn't allowed to write in that one time that I offered to.
You're not.
Exactly, so I didn't
do
it.
That's why it's not... That's why I don't like you writing it.
Mm. All right.
Burn, just throw it out there. Prophecy, I don't normally do this, but Prophecy just sent an email, so you need to go get that. Like, stat.
Okay, I will. All right, we'll have another email. But before that email, start with Shola. And Shola writes, what are your thoughts on the Battlefront beta? Ooh. I found it to be rather boring after a few matches. The novelty of it being Star Wars is what kept me playing past the stage of, quote-unquote, this game is boring. Awesome visuals and sound design, but ultimately it is rather shallow in terms of gameplay. Also, the hero gameplay animations are quite laughable. Going by the beta, it feels like a game that has months from release, and I fear Electronic Arts / DICE are only releasing this to cash in on the Star Wars hype as the release of the movie nears. Maybe they are aiming for a 7 out of 10 game to match the movie title. LOL. All right, well, let's start there before I move on.
I think he described it perfectly. It's a novelty.
Yeah,
that's
what
I feel after playing it. It's a
novelty. I don't feel a 7 out of 10 game. I feel like probably a solid 8 out of 10 game.
What?
My issue. So, yeah, I think it's actually pretty fun from what I've played.
We don't do at 10 scale here. It's either at 5 or you don't scale it at all.
2 out of 5.
I would give it a 3.5.
3 out of 5.
I would give it a
3.5. Wait a second. You cannot say no 10-point scale and then go 3.5. You just made it a 10-point scale.
Exactly.
You have to choose one out of five
stars.
1, 2, 3, 4, or 5.
I'm going to give it a 3 so far.
I'm giving it a 3 out of 5 from what I've played. Yeah. I don't... We're going to talk about this a lot more. But that game deserves its EA Access treatment to see what it really is like. That's all I'm saying. It's a beta. Waiting for EA Access.
From what I played, 2 out of 5.
I'm gonna give it 1 out of 5.
Oh man, I think the controls are actually really solid.
No,
that's what I liked. I like the way it moves. I like the way it feels. My main issues, first, the graphics are shit on Xbox One. It's running at 720p. It's not 60 frames per second like it says. It dips into the 50s, probably high 40s sometimes. There's frame pacing issues, so the camera's really juddery whenever you move left to right. It doesn't feel polished at all. Obviously, it's a beta. Maybe this will improve, but I doubt it because from previous experience with Battlefield Hardline and Battlefield 4, the issues that were in the beta also showed up in the final game. So I'm not expecting good things when it comes to performance. Presentation seems pretty good. Like, the music's good. The sound design's good. The menus all look really cool. Currently, the party support is not working right. Like, you can't invite people to your games, stuff like that. So that's kind of an issue. It doesn't seem like there's going to be a lot to do in the game. There's a bunch of game modes, but there's no single player like storyline or anything. I mean, there is a co-op mode where you can get with a buddy and do some horde type stuff. But even then, it seems like it's light on content. And for the people who do love this game, I think it's going to be similar to Titanfall in that it won't really last very long as far as, I guess, being in the news, you know?
All I would want to say is when this comes out for EA Access to play the trial, play this, play Battlefield 4, which is going to be there, and play Hardline, and see which one you like. Because honestly, it's just one of those games with a skin on top. And if you like Hardline better,
no,
or Battlefield...
No, it's not. It's
this
not.
One's a little more casual. There's no recoil in any of the guns, so it has
no
little
recoil,
bit different feeling
to it. Which is nice. I'll give you that. But here's my issues. The 15th time I heard the fucking Star Wars theme after a 2-minute period of not hearing it because somebody hit a power up or some stupid shit was very fucking annoying. Which I was over it.
The jetpacks are fun though.
The jetpacks are cool. Actually, flying in the shit was awful. Not good.
What I thought was weird,
vehicle combat kind of sucks. I didn't like
it. Well, what's weird about the vehicles, they're not already on the map. You see like a little icon on the ground, you walk over and it's like, okay, you have the vehicle now. And then you press the bumpers and then it puts you in the vehicle randomly. So it doesn't feel very organic as far as the experience is concerned in the same way that Battlefield does.
It felt like
a
janky N64 game.
I think you guys are being a little critical. My opinion is
critical. Oh, I could be so much fun.
I don't think it looks like shit. I think it looks pretty good.
Lighting's good. The shadow's good. Yeah.
The explosions are nice.
Yeah, the particles, all that. Yeah.
I give it. I don't really agree, but Dustin is putting his foot down, so I will go with a 3 out of 5. I will buy this game. But what the writer, the letter writer said.
Bad Tim. You buy it on PC. You buy it.
I don't know. My opinion is it's something you should try on, EA Access. It's great to have EA Access to try it. It's pretty good. I think it's going to be like an 80 Metacritic, around there. The letter writer, what was the name? Sholem?
Shola.
Shola's pretty spot on with everything. I did kind of feel that way. I feel like it could get a little old. It hurts that there's no single player, and being an Xbox guy, I have both consoles, but this is an Xbox show. You're going to have two first person shooters that are pretty high above this, and Titanfall and Halo 5. So, to be honest, if you want to be smart and get it on sale, that's probably the best thing if you can wait. But I'm not smart. I'm probably going to get it day one because it's Star Wars. And it is pretty cool sometimes. But, yeah, it has some problems. It definitely has some issues. But I probably liked it the most out of everyone here.
All right. If you want to play a game with laser guns and shit in it, and I hate to say it, buy Destiny. Skip this piece of shit and just buy something.
It's not a piece of shit.
The Xbox version is a POS. It's a piece of shit.
Yeah, the Xbox version is pretty bad. But
it looks like aliasing all over it, like nonstop, because there's no anti-aliasing in the game at all. It just looks all. It doesn't. Yes, the textures look all right if you're standing still, and it's like
the lighting looks really good too.
Awesome.
But yeah, the shadows are awesome.
720p ruins it.
And it really does.
The texture. Okay, so I went into the level with the stupid, what is it? The survival mode, and you're in like the desert.
Tatooine.
Looks really cool, except that everything's fucking popping in every 2 seconds, every foot you walk. So it just destroys the immersion. So you don't care. Like, yes, I like the fact that I don't like I got no recoil to my guns. That's fun, but
it's just bizarre. It's not
appealing. It's like
you're like 60 frames per second. You're like 60 frames per second. Sounds awesome, but your trade-off is 720p. Okay, it's 720p. Well, it better be a lock 60 frames per second, and it's not even close to that.
Well, to be fair, I appreciate that it's probably not going to be some vastly different game, but I think we should give them a little bit of credit that it's still got
for what
a month to go, and this isn't the final build either.
No, that's what I said. EA Access. It deserves an EA Access shot as an Xbox gamer. But
it's easy to it's hard to not be a skeptic in this situation though, because based on what we saw with Battlefield Hardline and Battlefield 4, there was no improvement from beta to launch.
It's
pretty
clear why they weren't allowing people to record this game at conventions. That's what I just want to say.
Well, from what I hear on PS4, it actually runs pretty smoothly, and it's at 900p, so it probably looks quite a bit better. But
it's
probably
PS4 first. They're probably developing it on the PS4 first. So,
I don't think for a $60 price point that is worth your money this Christmas.
Yeah.
Not with Fallout and Tomb Raider and Halo 5 and Uncharted.
I
have
better options. If you got, and I hate to mention it over and over again, but you got Destiny. Destiny's way better if you want a sci-fi laser gun fight. Like it plays better.
And
has
I know
a solid
you guys,
frame rate.
I know you guys disagree, but if you want a similarly playing game, try out Battlefield 4 if you've never played it. There's shit tons of content.
Get EA Access. Hardline comes out. What is it?
That's what I'm saying.
14th.
Yeah. Play
this month.
Play Hardline.
Play Hardline.
You'll be excited. It'll be awesome. Like, do that. I don't know. I can't. As of what I've played from that beta, I cannot recommend that game. Not with all these amazing games coming out. This is like we have an awesome lineup. That's not it. That's not.
We'll
what
talk about it again once it comes to EA Access and we've tried it.
Yeah.
Like,
we're not.
Okay, next part of the letter. Phil Spencer's prediction about PlayStation 4 price drop came true. In the same interview regarding the price drop, he mentions Microsoft having plans to combat this. What do you think they are? My guess is 500 gigabyte model going down to 300 in November permanently.
I agree with what Vern said before, is that they're probably going to do that. It's a limited time deal. I think you said that, Vern. We were discussing
this. I don't remember.
One of us said it's going to do the same thing they did last time, where they're going to come out and say it's on sale, and it's a limited time offer.
Like, no, I think they're going to bring it down to 300 for the 500
permanent gigabyte. Straight up.
Yeah, I think they're just going to bring it down to 300 for the remaining models because they're not making new 500 gigabyte consoles. So they'll sell the Master Chief Collection ones that are still remaining. They'll sell the Gears ones that are on the shelves right now at GameStop. They'll sell the Lego ones that are.
Why did you say that? Why do you say that?
Soon. Well, listen, and then they'll sell the white ones with Gears. I think all of those will hit $300. That's my guess. And I think the rest of them are going to go down to 350. And then
you make 1 terabyte the standard SKU.
Yeah, and once 1 terabyte becomes the standard SKU next year, maybe like around, I don't know, Quantum Break, they'll do a price drop and make that one 300 or something. You know?
They're not gonna mess with it that much.
Yeah.
Then I don't think they're gonna do that. I think that's too much too quickly.
What's too much about that?
300? They have to.
For the 500 gigabyte?
For the 1 terabyte one to be 299.
Well, no, the 1 terabyte won't be. That won't be until down the road.
350.
Yeah, it'll be 350 now.
You just said for Quantum Break.
Quantum Break, that's all the way in April of next year, so.
That's like 6 months away.
March, yeah. I don't remember March or April. I don't remember. I think it's early April.
5th of April. They're not going to put the 1.9.
Yeah, but if they're out of $300 consoles by the time that comes out, and they're gonna go back up to 350 essentially. No, they're not going to do that.
This is my opinion on the whole thing. Okay, they are not going to do anything other than promotion the hell out of this. The 500 is not discontinued. I already asked people about that. It's not discontinued. So.
Are they bundling the new controllers with new 500 gigabyte models then?
Well, they're not discontinuing the. I asked, are you discontinuing the 500 gigabyte model? And the answer was no.
So they're making new ones.
I asked specifically, are you discontinuing the 5? And they said no. They are not going to drop the price. What you're going to get is you're going to get $329. Xbox One at Walmart with a free game, 3 months of Xbox Live.
That's a price drop from $329.
Well, it's all going to be discounts. It's all going to be brick and mortar house discounts per what you know. They're all scattering around. So Microsoft's going to have a store get 3 games for. Get 3 games, get NBA 2K16 and a game of a choice, you know.
Well, they're already doing that right now.
Yeah, what I'm saying is when they're getting closer, they're going to do that, but they're going to add another game. They're going to out-bundle, they're going to out-promotion the competition. I'm pretty sure about that. On Black Friday, $299 Xbox with a game. They do not want to corner themselves in with another temporary price drop because what happened last year.
Well, I don't think it'll be temporary. I think they're
going to. It's not going to be permanent. They are not going to put a permanent price drop. I will hold firm on that. That is going to happen next year, and Sony is going to, and then they will be at the price point next year. Sony's not going to drop. So this is, you know, it's just the way it's going to go. In a year, it's going to be $299, and Sony's going to be $349. And then in a year after that, Sony's going to come down to $299. Xbox is looking to make revenue. They're looking to make some money year over year. They got to show money over year over year.
They need market share.
They need market share, too, but they also need revenue. They were down on the
revenue,
first...
you can go 300 and get revenue. Revenue,
well, yeah, well,
not
they're not going 300. They're going to go. They're going to promotion the
I think 300.
Help. I can tell. I'll bet you. I don't want to bet, but a gentleman bet that it is not going 300. They're not going to go.
Well,
they're not going to do
all,
that.
All I would say is, if they want to recreate what they had last year in the holiday months, they're going to have a $300 bundle.
They're not going to do that.
I'm saying that's what they would have to do. I'm not saying that's what's going to happen.
Steve, what are they doing in Great Britain?
They're actually more expensive than the PS4 again, so good job. What I was going to say before Tim spoke, because what Tim said made a lot of sense to me, was that I didn't feel a price drop was coming, because I can't see them wanting consumers to look at Xbox and go, hey, you know what, next holiday they're just going to drop it by $50 again. I think they don't want to look predictable, because if they do it this year, and then people, you know, they're going to start looking next year and they go, okay, why don't we just wait till November and they'll drop it again. Like, I think that they probably should drop the price, but I don't think that they will. And the reason why I should is because I think that having your console the same price as the PS4, pretty much regardless of kind of the bundles you're doing, I don't think that's going to end well for them. But ultimately, you know, if they feel the revenue's the most important thing, you know, I can completely understand that. You know, so I wasn't particularly feeling a price drop. Originally I was, but then I changed my mind. Like, what Tim said makes a lot of sense to me. But I do think that perhaps they might turn around and do one perhaps before you might think next year, because they don't want this cycle of every holiday we're going to drop 50. Like, wait perhaps 18 months, and then might drop it sort of first, depending on how they feel about Quantum Break, perhaps they might drop it for then, and then they could wait like an extra 18 months, which would be holiday 17 or something, and perhaps that would give them a bit more leeway to, rather, because as it stands, if you start getting a pattern of every holiday will drop 50, people will start realizing it, and people will start
reacting to that. And that's the final word by Steve. That's right, Steve. Next part of the letter.
Last part of the letter, actually. Lastly,
still the next.
What are your thoughts on the staggered release content model 343 Interactive are using for Halo 5, with Forge slated for December and a to-be-determined date for Big Team Battle? I think it is smart. With two other major first-person shooters releasing after Halo 5, saving a major piece of content like Forge for a later release would help give the game the atmosphere of a second launch. Thank you for reading. Well, thank you for writing, Shola. And I think it's a good idea.
I think it says that they're not rushing the content and actually putting time into making it.
Well, and it's practically two games at launch. I mean, Warzone's huge, it looks like. So,
and we'll be getting Warzone maps after launch this year, I think.
But like Warzone and Arena Mode could almost be sold on its own when you look at something like Battlefront. So that they're selling that with the single player campaign as well. I mean, it's a good value at launch, so you're not missing out on anything at launch. And then, you know, come November and December, maybe November will be Big Team Battle, and then December will be Forge. So it'll keep the game relevant over the course of the holidays instead of just coming out in October and that's it.
I think part of this is you're not going to be able to appease everyone. Some people are going to be like, well, look, it means you're not getting the whole game. It means this is bullshit. And then, I mean, straight up, after Master Chief Collection, I don't think they want to release anything that hasn't had the correct amount of time put into it, you know? That's why I think Big Team Battle is delayed. I mean, it partly has to do with they want people to play Warzone. But I know they've already announced they're making dedicated Big Team Battle maps, and they will be launching alongside Big Team Battle. And for when Forge launches, you'll be able to have 1,600 plus objects. Like, they're definitely putting their work into it. I think they're going to get it to the point where you're actually going to be able to make Warzone maps with Forge.
Well, that'd be cool.
I don't know. I think I definitely don't think it's a bad thing. We'll have plenty to do.
I think it's good. But if I were them, when I had people reviewing the game, I don't quite know what they should do. They just do like an early access on the console or something. Would give them some access to Big Team Battle, even if it's just like one map, so that they can look at that and incorporate that into things. Just say, hey, just so you know, this full thing is coming, but we played it and actually, and Halo 5 is pretty cool. I mean, you always, I guess, you run the risk of them saying, actually, it kind of sucks compared to Warzone, but. You know, I still think it's something that's been sort of quite important to Halo. I think they should Like when Bungie bitched last year about reviews and, oh, why are you reviewing our game even though the raids aren't done and stuff? They should have just had people come and play it.
Problem with they'll play it and they'll be like, wow, this is so good, but it's not in the game at launch.
Well, but this is the reason why, you know, but if they turn around to people and say, you know what, it's not in the game at launch, but it is coming, because I don't think a reviewer, if you let them play it, I think that they will probably, you know, they'll mention it, that, you know, even if they don't turn around and say, oh, I'll give you an extra 2 points for this, or I'll give you an extra star or something, they will, you know, they will mention it and say, you know, it's not there at launch, it's coming on, you know, this date. You know, I think it's something that they should do. If you're withholding content, you know, even if it's sort of justifiably so, I would try and give people the chance to experience it in some way so that they can mention it, because I think that will help.
I don't think either thing is big enough to hurt the score, even if they don't. Because, I mean, Big Team Battle is basically just Big Arena. And you can play Arena and get a feel for, okay, what would it be like if there were more players? Like, it's not radical. And I don't think anyone's ever based scores on Forge for Halo. I think most reviewers probably have never even really touched Forge. I think most Halo players haven't really touched Forge, other than played on Forge maps.
I think it'll be all right with the content it has at launch for reviews. I don't think that'll be an issue.
They have a lot. I went to an event and I talked to, I didn't get his name, but he's on the video. He's bald.
That's all that matters. He's a bald man.
You talk to Sachi
and he said that was it's ridiculous the amount of content they have.
Yeah,
he says maybe too much. You know,
this is actually a good lead-in for our final email. Well, first off, this last email is from Prophecy, as we call him, Prosify. The name of the email is called Wrong. That's the name of it. Wrong.
Okay.
And he says, hey, gentlemen, you guys rock. Everyone, except for Steve, because he's wrong. Always. Damn. About everything. All the time. Just saying, Steve, you're wrong. In all seriousness, I enjoy the podcast. Keep up the great work. On to the question. If you had to choose just one game to play / purchase this holiday on Xbox, which would it be and why?
Well, there's only one answer to that, and that's the game Steve is wrong. I mean, he is.
Well, Steve, what are you going to say to the answer to this question?
I would probably have said Metal Gear Solid 5.
Right, you're wrong. Yeah, it's Halo 5.
Yeah, it's Halo 5.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's Halo. I mean...
And it's big, and it's got lots of content. It's going to last you throughout the rest of the year and into next year. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's got shit coming out for it the rest of the year.
Yeah.
There's going to be like 39 maps by March for Halo multiplayer.
The other understandable or the other accurate or good answer would have been Fallout 4.
Yeah, that's a good one too.
I haven't decided if I'm going to get that day one or not.
Everything about Metal Gear.
I'm starting to lean towards the fact that I probably will, or I might wait a couple of weeks and play Tomb Raider.
Why would you play that game? They made Lara Croft a victim. Aren't you triggered?
I got that shit pre-ordered now.
It looks beautiful, by the way.
It does. Yeah.
They keep dropping the price of it over here. It started at like 50, and now it's just way down to 40. I think they're playing how low can you go.
Don't worry, they won't cut it no more, Steve. They don't want you to get used to their games.
They need
to
bundle it with every Xbox purchase.
Yeah.
Console purchase.
That way there's a Tomb Raider 3 for Vern.
They should bundle every single game with every Xbox purchase. It'd be like one there of those 52-in-1 games are all on the motherboard.
Yeah.
Got Rare Replay, man. Rare Replay.
All right. Well, thank you so much for writing a prophecy. Thanks for making my day by just telling Steve he's wrong. Please tune into last week's podcast to understand why that email though is the way it is.
Fucking evil.
So I was at work just to fill people in, like watching the show on Twitch while at work, and I just kept writing in a chat, hey, tell Steve he's wrong. I can't barely watch the show because it keeps going to like loading and it wouldn't stream correctly, so just tell him he's wrong. And I finally get home and it's at the very end of the podcast and I got to go on a rant about how Steve's wrong. I felt good. But thank you, Prophecy. Thanks for writing in. And you can write in, too, at letters@xboxuncut.com.
And we didn't even start the news yet. It's an hour in. All right.
Yeah, but that's why we do letters. Letters are important.
I know they are.
Important. And we got to go through some of the news already through the letters.
It's true.
Not all of it.
Not all of it, but it means we get to cut down on talk through the news and get, you know, what we've been playing. But for right now, let's get into news. Are we ready? Are you stoked to hear that Layers of Fear is coming to the Xbox One?
Xbox
the hell's
Game
Layers
preview.
Of Fear. Oh, like, yeah, the preview, yeah.
It's like a PT style horror game. First person exploration. And it says
they're
that
putting a demo up on the store, then taking it down forever later. Like, it's gonna be great. It's gonna be great.
But they were saying like there's parts in the game where you can turn the camera, look at something, turn around, and it'll be something different. Like it's a dynamic horror game, and it's kind of like PT from what I've seen. So if you're into horror games, check it out. I mean,
that sounds terrifying.
Yeah.
Don't worry, Steve. They're making it just for you. All right, moving on. Call of Duty Black Ops 3 digital version for Xbox pulled from Xbox Game Store and Amazon. Now, what's
going
on, guys?
Both the standard and limited editions.
Why are they pulling my Black Ops 3? How am I supposed to play this game, Vern? How am I supposed to play
it? This is a weird one. This is a weird one. I don't understand what's going on.
A lot of the conspiracy theories are that Sony is working with Activision to stop the amount of digital pre-orders on Xbox.
I don't think that's it.
Here's the thing, though. Here's the thing that it makes all this so confusing. Microsoft came out, and they said it's temporarily removed from the Xbox Store, and that they're working with Activision to return it as soon as possible. But then Activision said they did not remove the digital version of Call of Duty Black Ops 3 from the Xbox Store. So they have interfering explanations on what's going on here, and it doesn't make sense. If it's a problem, it's got to be either a problem with the game, it can't be a problem with the pre-order system, because
I think it's
the
a technical
only game
issue.
Affected it can't be well it has to be a technical issue with that specific game, because the limited edition and the standard edition.
What I'm thinking, I bet when it goes gold is when it'll
but
go back up.
Here's the thing, though. Why is it removed from Amazon also, then?
Because if you use the if you buy the Amazon card and then put the digital code maybe into the Xbox, it'll maybe something along those lines, or it'll download and they don't want you downloading it just yet. I don't know.
It's so strange that all a pre-order is something that says you're entitled to the game.
This kind of happened with Evolve the other way around, though, because Xbox got to pre-load it and PS4 didn't. So I don't know what's going on.
But preloads always go up much later on PS4 anyway. It's always literally like 2 days before, whereas Xbox is always weeks.
Yeah, weeks before. But
right when it goes gold, yeah.
I am putting this message out there. If people started getting exclusive rights to preload games on consoles before release, I will bash you nonstop. If it's Nintendo, if you
wouldn't
get
put
the
it
exclusive
past Sony.
Rights...
Dude, we've already had...
I will bash the ever-loving shit out of you for doing that.
But here's the thing.
This is the scummiest thing you can do.
Here's the thing, though. We already had worse. Sony had exclusive rights to announce a game.
For Diablo.
And even say it's coming.
Well,
it wasn't
fair.
Exclusive on their platform.
Because eventually announced the Xbox version and said, yes, it's coming.
Like a week before or a few days before it came out.
It's
it was really
cool.
Weird.
It was awful.
No, but you know what? That's better than fucking sitting there and go, we're not going to let you preload the game to the last minute because we're Sony and you're Microsoft,
that's
so
like,
fuck you and your fans.
No, Dusty, that's like saying, oh, this game is exclusive to the PS4 in like 2 weeks before it comes out. It's not.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was doing. And a lot of people didn't even know if Diablo was definitely going to come out for the 360. But then when it happened with the PS4 and Xbox One, everyone just assumed it would come out for Xbox One because of what happened back with PS3 and 360.
This is
so.
Just such an
odd
situation.
No, but look, all I'm saying is if you start getting exclusive rights just to preload your game onto a console and stop the other console from being able to preload, that's just going to be a shitty rabbit
hole. It's stupid, yeah. It's stupid, and I wouldn't put Sony past it. You know, like I wouldn't put it past Sony. Yeah, because you look at the thing with
But isn't that illegal though?
Like, Diablo?
No, it's not illegal.
No,
there's nothing.
But you look at what they did with Diablo, and then you look at all their exclusive content. Whenever they work out these marketing deals, it's generally something that will be exclusive to PS4, like exclusive content that won't even come to Xbox One until a way later date, you know, not at all.
I think we will know if this is a Sony thing, because it'll appear exactly as the PS4 preload does. That's how we'll know. But I'll be honest, I don't subscribe to the fact that it's Sony. I just think I'm gonna err on the side of not being that cynical and just think that it's something else.
I don't think it's technical difficulties. It just doesn't make sense when no other games face this.
No, but it could be Microsoft going, their game's fucked. We're not even putting it up for preload until you get it fixed. And could then be. we'll put it up for preload. Like that, it could.
I think that's
more realistic.
I don't understand where you guys are coming from, and I've been confused on this whole thing. How could they? Why could Sony have any kind of bearing on what Microsoft's selling?
Because it's contract. It's not. Microsoft doesn't have control over the Xbox Store technically. If a publisher wanted to remove their game, they can freely. So the problem here that people are having, what the conspiracy theory is going, is that if Sony's doing it, it's doing it to inflate the digital sales by removing its ability to pre-order it on Xbox One.
Yeah.
Well, that's I kind of find that illegal.
It wouldn't be illegal because it's their product.
Well, people who have already pre-ordered Call of Duty Black Ops 3 have said that it already started downloading the game, and it's like a full goal download. Well, once that happened was when it got pulled.
Yeah.
So maybe they want to time it with the same time you can preload on PS4 because they think it's giving the Xbox One sales an advantage, and they have a contract with Activision.
The shady thing is removing it from the store. That's the shady ass thing.
But why has it been removed from the store? It's been on there since E3.
We don't know why, but like there could be a million different reasons. Yeah, there could be an issue with the Xbox version where they're like, we're not going to allow people to preload it because the game's fucked up. It's not passing cert. You need to pass cert, and then you can start letting people preload. It could be as simple as that. We don't know.
Here's one thing to think about. If it was just technical difficulties on Amazon, it would have just said unavailable.
Yeah,
they wouldn't remove the digital version of the game. It would just come up saying the pre-order is currently unavailable. It completely removed it from the Amazon store. It has no store page for the digital version of the game on Xbox One anymore.
Steve, do you got anything else to comment? And then we're going to move on.
Nah, that's right.
I think it'll work out, and you'll be able to preload it and everything in a little bit. So
it's just shady. That's all I think.
I don't know. It's weird. We'll talk about it later if we get more info. Yeah. I guarantee it'll be back up for pre-order, but
yeah.
It's whatever. Rise of the Tomb Raider Season Pass includes Endurance Mode, 2 extra tombs to explore. Find out about the other content also included in the pass here. What else is coming in this stupid little pass?
It looks like it's one
packs.
It's like one tomb. It's a some kind of endurance mode thing, and then like a horde mode kind of thingamajig or something.
Yeah.
It looks like only one of the three things is going to be any kind of story-based content, which I'm guessing the tomb thing might be. But all the other stuff is just like single-player leaderboard stuff. And then you earn all these packs, which give you different upgrades and abilities to use them to get higher scores. And that's what the microtransactions are. It looks like a pretty weak season pass, honestly.
Yep.
Well, what
sounds
you get
like
is
awful value for $30. I mean, I would pay like maybe like.
It depends on how big these tombs are. That's all I'm saying.
And they make it sound like if you buy the season pass, you're gonna get all the content they release too, like outfits, weapons. And
stuff
like
that.
But they're releasing expedition cards too, and these expedition cards can be anything from. You can have a gun for a single use in one of your in single player, or in a challenge mode that someone set up, or you can have big head mode, or you can have like it's basically like the rec resistance that they're doing with Halo 5.
Or the mods in Forza.
Yeah, it's think that but you have the ability to buy these with real money.
Which is kind of stupid if you're just playing a single player game. I don't
know. Yeah, when it was sort of rumored that it would have microtransactions, I was like, how on earth are they going to do it? And then when they explained how they do it, I was like, oh, so basically they really, 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 really fucking wanted to put microtransactions in, but had absolutely no way of doing anything that completely sounds non-stupid. So just thought, fuck it. We know this is stupid, but this is what we're going to do. Because it just, yeah. I mean, dumb is being awfully polite. It's fucking ridiculous.
They were like, go dumb or go home. That's right.
It's not hurting anyone, though. Just buy the $60 game, and then if you want the tomb, you can buy that separately and
I guarantee this was part of their deal with having the exclusivity, was having something in there for some extra money.
I bet the PS4 version does not have the microtransactions. Oh, we listened
I bet it does.
And we decided to take them out. I guarantee
that's crazy, Steve. I think they're going to have it on
I think it'll have them.
Again, yeah, Steve is wrong.
But I think the season pass will be bundled in as the, you know, for the regular
Yeah, that's really about that.
All right. Well, now that Steve's wrong, let's move on to Halo 5 is gone. Halo 5 goes gold, people.
Halo 5's gone? Halo 5's gone!
It's gone. They're taking the pre-orders off the store. They pulled it off Amazon.
Activision bought it.
Exclusive to PS4.
Tim Dog started deleting his tweets about Halo. I mean, it's gone. They're getting rid of it.
Tim started making tweets.
Yeah, like it's over. It's over. But yes, it's gone gold. That means Halo 5 is actually being printed on disc and getting ready to go into your Xbox and
isn't there like a huge day one patch again?
Yes.
No, but there's Halo. It's all on the disc, Steve. What do you mean day one patch? That's not what this generation's about, Steve. This generation's about disc being ready to go.
I'm tired of this dumb argument. We survived Master Chief Collection. We'll survive Halo 5.
I think this won't be as bad as Master Chief Collection.
No, it won't.
Master Chief was a 30. It was a 30 gig.
20.
It was really big. Yeah.
That was a very large day one patch.
I think we'll survive.
Well, yeah, but...
I mean, if you got a data cap, I mean, that's just part of having a data cap.
Well, I'm not so bothered. In my opinion, they need to let you...
The problem is...
Fuck you.
They need to let you preload.
Yeah, even for people with discs, they need to let you download it before you get it, but you just can't play it until you put the disc in.
No, this patch is going to preload. Oh, I know what you're saying. When you get the disc,
it's not going to preload
for people who are disc only. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, then buy digital. Damn it. I know that was a bad thing.
No, but like Microsoft needed to do this from the get go because the original plan was you'd be able to load up any Xbox game, even if you didn't own it, and that way, once you bought it, it was there. They need to bring that system in somehow. So at least with patches, where it could be like, you know what, I'm buying this game. Go ahead and download this. That way, when it shows up,
well, what they should pre-patch. Do is when you buy a game on the disc, let you have a code, and then you can go to Microsoft's website and be like, it could be a pre-order code. You go to their website, you put in the code, and they say, all right, this is legit, no one else has used it before, and they give you a code to put in the Xbox store, and you can preload. Doesn't let you play the game.
No, you would need a code. They just need to make it where everyone can do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
Because you still need the disc to work as the DRM, yeah.
Yeah.
Just let me download the patch. Like, have a patch store where I can download patches for my stupid games so that I don't have to sit there and preload patches.
Well,
preload patches.
I mean, generally speaking, install times, I wouldn't say they're terrible, but they're still not great. So I think they you know, because Phil's talked before about trying to solve that problem, and I did tweet him about just letting us install the game off the store. Obviously we just can't play it if there's no license, and you'd say, oh, that sounds like a good idea, and then 2 years later or something they haven't done anything. But
well, the thing with that is that how many people would download it and use up the bandwidth and use up server time and everything and then not buy the game? And that's probably what they're thinking, is that how much money are we going to waste on people downloading this shit and just never buying it?
That's why I don't care. I just want them to give me what I want. All right, now, anybody have anything else to add about Halo 5?
Don't go. Buy it!
Buy it. Final word by Vern.
Thanks, looks
Vern.
Great.
Moving on. Forza Motorsport 6 updates. New card releases with October Logitech G card pack. So we got the 1939 Mercedes-Benz W154, blah, 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 car, car, car. Jason,
can
just
I
go
talk
run
about
me
it?
Through this so we can get past it.
All right. Hold on. Jesus Christ. Okay, there's going to be a little bit we got to go over, especially for people that play Forza, because this is actually a big patch they released for the game. They corrected the 2016 Ford Mustang Shelby GT350's engine sounds, which was a big problem. They also corrected the V8 supercars, so they have the correct engine sounds for the cars, improved cockpit positioning. Here's a very big one for people, that, especially leaderboard guys. The 1965 and the smaller, lighter cars, people were putting engine swaps, and it was allowing the cars to perform beyond their performance index was supposed to. So they went ahead and fixed that, and they're wiping the leaderboards.
<I'm> kidding.
Actually, this is a huge-ass complaint.
I'm playing
play
about
this game. I know. So they're wiping
moving
the leaderboards. It's already
moving
happened.
On.
Dusty, shut the fuck up. They're investigating the issue where the lead car will pull far ahead from all the others in the single-player races.
Yeah, that happened to me a few times, actually.
Oh, wait, so it's not boring anymore?
Yeah.
All right.
Moving on.
They release a server-side fix that should help with the issue, and they're continuing to work on trying to fix that. They fixed an issue. Now you can transfer all of your Forza Motorsport 5 liveries over, which was a big thing because people were having issues. The World Traveler achievement now works. So I had so many people complain to me about achievements. Fixed an issue where only two cars are able to pit at a time, and it will now fix your headlights if you pit. And you can actually pit while AI cars are rewinding. That's been a problem in Fortress for a while. This month's free DLC car for everyone is the 2015 Infiniti Q60 concept car. And some cool-ass cars in this car pack. I love it. It's a bunch of racing cars. The DLC pack is $7 if you don't have a season pass, or if you have a season pass, just go ahead and play it. We're good to go.
Forza. All right, done.
Yay, Forza!
All right, Tales of the Borderlands Episode 1 is now free. Go play it, because it's fucking awesome.
It is.
The Sprint Season 3, Episode 1 and 2 are now released, so if you want more Halo fun and news and adventures,
it was great.
Great. It's going to be great. They're releasing more episodes later this month. Even after the game comes out, it's going to be fucking awesome. Button mapping coming to all controllers soon, says Mike Ybarra. So we all thought it was going to be an Xbox, like an Elite controller only feature for whatever reason, but it looks like they're giving it to everybody.
This is different, actually.
No, it is different.
With the Elite controller, they're mapping. Well, with the Elite controller, they're saving the profiles to the actual controller. With this, it's something that's on the system side, on the actual console side.
The plus to the Elite controller is there's less input lag.
Well, we don't know for sure if there's going to be any real input lag if you do use this accessibility feature yet. I guess we'd have to get some tests and see. But there's a likelihood of input lag compared to the Elite controller,
it has,
yes.
Yeah, the Elite controller has onboard... It'll just
do onboard memory,
instantaneous. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the plus. All right, Cortana won't be available for everyone on Xbox One until 2016. Plan Xbox Preview members to receive Cortana later this year. So, you will not be able to go, hey, Cortana, is Vern online? Is the Golden Throat online, Cortana? And it'll be like, shut up. Yes, he is.
Hey, Cortana, is Steve naked?
Of course.
All right. Can neither confirm nor deny. But you do know that there's a way of finding it, right?
There's a trick, but it's not officially in the preview yet.
Ah, yeah, but who cares about that?
Yeah.
No, but we're talking about officially coming out. Part of the system level won't be till 2016. So even though they're going to release...
For preview, no.
No,
for...
but they're going to release the app for... the dashboard's coming out in November for everyone, not just preview members. But you still won't get Cortana until 2016. No matter what. Unless you're in a preview members, and then you could try Cortana this year when they update it for preview members without doing a stupid workaround to make it work. All right. Any other? Yes? No? Moving on. Star Wars Battlefront Impressions. Yeah, we gave those. It's not
three out of five.
3 out of 5.
1.5 out of 5.
It's not a 10-point scale, Steve. Shut
that
up.
Means it's a 2.
No, it's a 5-point scale.
Look, Steve is a heavyweight. On our Metacritic, look, Steve is a heavyweight. So
look, Steve, I got to explain something to you. If I say it's a 2 out of 10, Vern can instantly say that's a 1.5 out of 5. You know why? Because it's the same amount of fucking numbers. As a 10-point scale. That's why we do a 5-point scale. A 3 out of 5 is playable, but I wouldn't recommend it, but it's okay. Like, it's an alright game. Like, it's not great. It's not, you know, it's just, it's there. It's a game. If you really wanted to waste money on it, do it. 3 out of 5.
3 out of 5 is just 60%, isn't it?
Depending on the scale you're going off of. Or who does this game. Most people would say a 3 out of 5 is just a run-of-the-mill okay game. It's not great. It's not even good. It's just an.
We decided this. A 1 out of 5 is anywhere from 0 to 20. A 2 out of 5 is anywhere from 20 to 40. 3 out of 5 is anywhere from 40 to 60. 4 out of 5 is anywhere from 60 to 80. And a 5 out of 5 is anywhere from 80 to 100.
Yeah. So you're going essentially, percent. If you're doing a 3 out of 5, it's like, yeah, it's not awful, but it's not good. Just
Excalibur, expect every Xbox exclusive to get an 8 out of 5 from GameSpot. So
that's right.
They're pretty much, they're on a running, like, Forza got an 8 out of 5, or 8 out of 10, you know. They got, Forza got an 8 out of 10, Gears of War got an 8 out of 10. I think Rare Replay got an 8 out of 10 or some shit. They're on a roll, so don't stop them now.
All right, well,
Halo, they'll give it a little higher, but it won't be a 9.
8.5.
8.7.
Yeah.
It's gonna be
they're only a 0.0 scale.
A 0.0 scale?
I think they'll give it a 9.
What's a 0 out of 5? That would be your email, Wicked.
All right.
I'm sorry.
New Xbox dashboard impressions. How do you like it, Burn?
I like it. There's still some issues. Obviously, it's very early still. There's a little bit of input lag when you're kind of going up and down through the menus on when you snap the left side, you know. The activity feed is still going to be completely redone from what I hear, so that's kind of useless right now. The achievements app is still not complete. It just uses the old one, or at least the old Snap one. They did change up a few things. Now when you now the Snap's, when you double-click the button, and it pulls up the left side, and then when you snap, it actually snaps on the right side, so the overlay can go over your Snap screen still. So, I like it so far. It's fast. It's really fast to invite people to party, to get rid of people in party if you want to. So, I like that.
My favorite feature, and I know this sounds so dumb, is the fact that when you're on, like if you're highlighting over home on the main screen, and you slide over the store just expands.
Into, yeah, like, store's built games. Right into it. Yeah.
That is so good.
It's not an app. It's just games, apps, movies, TV, and music. Like, you just, it's right into the store. You're not, like, going, oh, I need to load up the app. And
it is an app still, actually, though. Even though they build the store into the front end.
Yeah.
It does load an app, sort of. But it's a lot faster. It's all integrated a whole lot better.
But the majority but just of the for store the, is right on the dash.
It's a 4 out of 5.
It's well, five for the basic five. Things, though, like starting programs, inviting people to party, it's really
it's an
fast.
8. It's an 8, Steve.
It's an 8 out of 10 for me right now.
It's a 5 out of 5?
It's
7.9. It's a 4 out of 5.
I'm going to go 4.5 out of 5.
Okay, yeah.
So what you're saying,
I think they
what you're saying on my scale is you're a 5 out of 5.
Like,
Steve.
There's still little bugs and strange little things, and like,
I hate your scale.
Me and Steve were talking, like, if you have something snapped and you want to change the, like, if I want to use the Snap tab, it can be kind of stupid to do it.
It's hard to switch back and forth. Yeah,
yes.
From one side to the other.
And then
you have to get the guide up, and then at the top it says resume whatever the game is,
yeah,
or
but it
whatever
just,
Snap Tap is.
It doesn't work as good as what they had. I think that's the problem. The funniest thing I found on the DAS is that if you unpin something, it takes you to the community tab. And I like, you unpin, and then it just snaps you over to the community tab for absolutely no reason. Yeah. But other than that, I love how snappy it is.
It, I really like it.
That's weird. Sorry, TimCon.
No, my only gripe about the whole thing is just the game section. I think it's better, but I just don't understand when you get to the end of the when you go all the way down where it says you need to check your pins, go check, you know, go to games and apps. I don't understand why it just doesn't populate the rest of the games. So you could just keep scrolling down until you're done.
Yeah, because they're not pinned.
Yeah, but you could have a second set of pin and a third set of pin.
You just don't like that they max the amount of pins you can have. Okay.
Yeah, I just think it should just roll. You know, because I do find that the game. Well, I have 152 games or something, so maybe it's that. But just seems to.
It's a problem when you can only go two at a time.
Right. Another thing that's kind of annoying, it doesn't put the little mark on games that were recently updated. So the only way you know if games were recently updated, well, there's two ways. You can sort by recently updated, or in the notifications, it'll show that it was recently updated.
Yeah,
so
they'll do that. They'll
add that. But yeah, there's just a bunch of little things here and there that need to be fixed, and it's still pretty early. Probably by next week it'll be even better. So
look, for the man that thinks it's a 5 out of 5, I'll tell you, when being on the straight, like on the dash and just clicking left on the D-pad and it pops in the sidebar, that's annoying. I don't like that. I'd rather the screen just comes over or pulls over and shows everything on the main dash. Like, I like how Windows Phone does it. I like how the Xbox Smart Glass on my computer does it. Just pull it over. Don't actually, dim the screen, flip it over. Like, I think that's a little too much for the dash, like the front end. And it's very, confusing. Like, if I'm in a game, it makes sense to
jarring,
dim the screen.
Yeah,
but if I'm actually just playing or, on the dash, I don't want to see. I don't want it, to clip on top of what I'm doing. It's just weird. Like you said, it's jarring. I don't like it. But if I was working on a 1,000-point scale, it'd be like an 800 out of 1,000, you know? It'd be great. It's really good, which is a 5 out of 5, which is amazing, you know?
Well, that's a 4 out of 5.
No,
it's 80.
No. An 80 on a 5-point scale is a 5 out of 5.
Or an 81 might be instead.
Yeah, an 81.
Think about it. Maybe.
An 801 out of 1,000?
So anything between 80 and 100... Pretty much, it's just it's.
What about an
81?
What about
maybe we should rethink this? I think it needs to be 81 to 100.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there any true thing called a zero at it? Like, I guess.
Could anything really be 100? So shouldn't it be 81 to 99?
No, it'd be 80 to 99. If you're going like that.
Okay. More importantly.
Nothing's perfect, right?
So the reason why I gave it a...
Hey, Vern, I think we are going to switch to colors. We're just out of red and blue. What blue. Do you feel this is? This is a green to me. It's a green.
Yeah.
We're going to go the Conan approach.
We're going to use Steve's magnets in order to...
Yeah.
I give it an orange 7.
Yeah. Wicked Soul pointed out, too, that it scrolls too fast through the games. Like if you're in the My Games and Apps section and you press the right bumper and you hold it, it just shoots all the way to the right instead of quickly going through. So that's kind of annoying. But yeah, there's just a bunch of little things. They'll get it worked out, though. I think in a couple of weeks it'll start looking pretty good. So
the reason why I gave it 5 out of 5 is because I look at the previous Dash. I mean, I haven't had it for a couple of weeks now, but... compared to this, that thing was just awful. It just got slower and buggier, and you know they did their best with it, but they knew this was coming. And this is a 5 out of 5 purely because it's just even
it's what
you
buy
better
in a game dashboard.
It's just all of it is just so much better. The store, it doesn't look so awful. I love the store. It looks really good. I've been very critical of the store. There's still a few things they need to sort of fix, but I'm not going to complain too much because it looks really good. And there's, you know, you've got the 6 box arts on the front, and then you can see all. And if you go in the store and you can scroll along a bit, and it looks nice. And there's a big sexy banner with Camilla Luddington on the top. And you've got all the little other boxes, and you know the thing that I think
I like the way it organizes the DLC too.
The one
it shoots
guy
it on the bottom, so you can see it all.
The one guy tab is really nice too. I don't know if you guys looked at that.
It still needs to integrate a few more things into it, but yeah, that does look nice.
I wish they would let me hide it. I don't
Yeah, they should let you hide tabs. Yeah.
It's less of a problem on this one, I think, because the way that the other one, it transitioned between each of them, whereas this one, I don't know, feels less there. But the one thing that I think I do dislike is when you obviously open on the homepage, you've got like your active game and you've got the guide stuff to the left. You go down and look at your sort of active apps. I was talking to Jason about this before the show started. Like, I understand why they're trying to show me all this information with Game Hub and friends playing and Game DVR and all that other stuff, but the boxes is just far too big.
Yeah,
like there's so much unnecessary space, and you know, they could. I think we said that they could sort of halve it, and it would be
awesome.
Same as I think, but nah, I love it. It looks really good. You know, it's fast. It, you know, as I said, there's still some kinks to work out, but
as a person that's used them all, like we've used the Nintendo one, the Sony one, the Xbox original one, this new Xbox one. It's definitely the best gaming UI out of all of them. Like it
works. It's the fastest to invite someone to party.
I don't know what you're talking about, guys. Blades beats everything.
No, it really doesn't.
There's fun.
I know people love Blades, but the Blades.
Blades is awful. No, this shit's great. The only problem I have with this new one is that I think it takes too long for the guide to come up. Like when you press left on the D-pad, you can count over a second before it comes up. Like it just takes too long right now. But it's not final yet, so that's really my only big complaint other than focusing snap objects and the one guide just taking too long to pop up. That's a lot of 950 out of 1,000. 950 out of 1,000.
I've had one problem where I'll press I'll be like in a game or in my game snaps or something. I'll press the guide and it will sit there thinking about it for a while, and then it'll say, no, something's wrong, I don't like this, and it will stop for a minute, and all of a sudden the Xbox will just turn off.
I didn't have that one yet. I have random apps just shutting down. Like Hulu just likes to close randomly.
I wish it would just come up with a screen saying something happened. I wish that was in there.
But no, it does. It says like something went wrong or something. Yeah.
But overall, we're all pretty positive, right?
Yes, like everybody's happy. 5 out of 5. Good.
Yeah, 5 out of 5.
Tim. 5 out of 5. Are you still there, Tim?
Yeah, I give it an 85. I'm getting off.
So 5 out of 5. Thank you.
Whatever you want to call it.
5 out of 5. I appreciate you supporting my scale. Me and Giant Bomb with Jeff Gertzman appreciate your support and your continued gratitude to this long process of Metacritic and destroying games because it's a 7 instead of a 5.
Can I say something about Jeff Gertzman, by the way?
Gertzman. You know what? For you, Steve, I'll let you do it.
I thought it was really funny this week that he gave Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 5 a 1 out of 5 and gave Gears of War Ultimate Edition 2 out of 5 because the two are not even remotely comparable. Like,
you can't
tell me that what Gears did was a whole 1 star above it, because not only did it work, it was completely redone graphics. You know, there's a ton of work.
Yeah, but here's the difference. You had to kill everybody to progress.
Well.
Oh, here's a special one, Steve, though. And I understand.
And it doesn't have horde mode.
Yeah.
And Tim will like this one too. They still haven't done a review for Forza 6.
No. Yeah, I don't understand that.
Do we really want them to?
No, but you know it's coming. Oh, and after all the reviews were done, a company did come out and give it a 6 out of 10. So it brought the Metacritic down.
You know what though? I don't think they're going to do a Forza review because Jeff Gertzman, he said, he was like, look, I love Forza 3. Forza 4 was, you know, was good.
Look, he already said...
But he was like, I'm not into these games anymore. Like, it's not my thing. And, you know, they haven't done a review, so I have a feeling they're just not going to do one. It's not this type of game.
Well, I loved his comment that everything except for the driving in Forza is bad. How do you make such a blanket statement? You know? I don't know.
All right, well... Let's move on. That was our dashboard impression.
We have more news?
Do we? Do we have more news?
Microsoft buys Havoc, but we already talked about that.
We talked about Havoc. Yeah. We talked about
Microsoft Devices event.
We really, yeah. Well, I could talk about that.
All right, let's break it down real quick. Microsoft has an event. They showed off the Surface Book, which is their first ever laptop. Looks cool. It's expensive, but it looks awesome. They showed off two new phones that actually hook up to the full displays, and they'll be computers. So if I hate to say it, they're positioning this for a third world market, where like the majority of those people actually use their phones for most of their business purposes, just so that they could have a display, pop their phone down, have a full working desktop, and put their computer right back in their pocket. So pocket PC's back. That's where Microsoft approach on the phone is. They showed off, what else did they show? Surface Pro 4 looks pretty awesome.
And all the amazing Xbox One bundles, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bundles.
Well, the interesting thing about the phones,
such a waste of time.
The interesting thing about the phones is that they're working on getting people to. They're going to allow people to. You could take the desktop version of VLC, put it in a wrapper, and then put it on the Microsoft Store, and you'll be able to run that on the phone.
Yeah.
So
there's so many stuff that you could do with this phone. I actually talked to the guy. You could actually wirelessly stream this to your Xbox One and run an application off of the phone on your Xbox One. It's crazy. It's a pocket PC.
Yeah,
pretty much.
It's a true pocket PC.
It's a true pocket PC.
You don't even need a cable.
To a monitor and keyboard, and away you go.
Yep.
You need the Surface little thing, the little box. Not Surface.
Not with Miracast.
You are correct. You don't need it. You can. It does work wirelessly, but the adapter is really cool.
No, it is. But I'm just saying, you can use Miracast. It's awesome. What else did they show?
Anything? Surface. The one thing I wanted to bring up, though, what I think is interesting, and I wonder if it will have any effect on the next Xbox, their partnership with NVIDIA on making custom silicon.
Yeah, that was cool.
They made a custom NVIDIA. The NVIDIA chip inside the Surface Book is not an off-the-counter NVIDIA chip.
Yeah, it makes you wonder.
Everyone was asking,
for the next console, if they go with NVIDIA.
Yeah, because everyone is asking, is this a 960M? Is this a 970? Is it a 980? It's like, no, it's none of that. It's a custom-built chip for the Surface. It's in no other device. So, yeah, it makes you wonder if
this is.
And
people are saying, but isn't AMD running DX12 stuff better than NVIDIA right now?
That's just because their chips don't perform as well, though.
Well, you're not talking the Surface doesn't.
Pause. It depends on the feature, Vern. There's certain features that NVIDIA has that AMD cards do not have that are DirectX 12 only. And then there's certain features AMD has that are DirectX 12 features that NVIDIA cards don't. So they both run, depending on the process, they both have advantages.
But that'd be pretty cool if they went with NVIDIA for their next console, though.
Yeah.
Tim, I would like that.
I'm trying because everybody's trying to talk. Tim, what were you going to say?
I don't know if you were saying the Surface. The Surface doesn't have the NVIDIA. It's the book.
Yeah,
the Surface book.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
Okay, the Surface book. It's the Surface 4, and Surface 4 pretty much is just kind of just an updated screen, two USBs. A little more storage, but I think it's the same processor and stuff like that.
If they can put a DGPU in a separate part and connect it, what does that mean for the Xbox? Does that mean
power
they
brick.
Put it in the power brick?
Well, it depends if they get someone with a competent vision and competent designer to look at
Mr.
the next
X,
Xbox
actually,
or not.
Mr. X was there. He, Mr. Media X, that was who designed the Surface.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Or the Surface Book.
I might be onto something.
I want, and it's the same thing people wanted for the Xbox One. The next Xbox, I want a magnesium body, something that looks close to the Surface, small. Like, if they can make this thing like they did with an i7 and one of the most powerful GPUs in a laptop and have it that thin, I mean, why can't we get something like that in a console? Like, why does the console have to be so big when a laptop can do this for 12 hours straight and not have to worry about overheating?
Well, to be fair, with the Xbox One, I mean, Satya, I think, is one of his big things is trying to get everyone to swim in the same direction, whereas rather than everybody being so separate, he's like, well, if you're making hardware and you're making hardware and you're making hardware, why doesn't we just have one group that makes hardware, which they're working towards, not necessarily
done. Yeah, they're working on that, yeah.
But with the Xbox One, they very specifically did that because they wanted no chance of Red Ring of Death, and to be fair, as much as the thing is an ugly beast, it was the right decision.
It's reliable.
I was in
the game store this week, and they've had, I don't know why I never mentioned this before, they've had the Halo 5 Xbox One for a while. I don't know if it's actually a working unit, but they've got one there. I was looking at it and I think, you know, that skin's kind of nice, but that box is just so goddamn big and hideous. It's just...
It's not hideous. It blends right into the like TV. It disappears.
There's not much to do with that.
I love that it's 16:9 to match the aspect ratio of my TV, so it just blends in under the cabinet and I don't see it. And it's just a little white light. Like, it works perfect. It is exactly what I want in a console.
Well, they did
specifically,
yeah.
It doesn't need to be a fucking small purple fucking box with the boat hanger on the back so that I can rip it down with the rope. No, I don't need that. I'm not 5 years fucking old anymore. It doesn't need to be a Comic Sans font where it's all tilted to one side like the PS4. It could just be a simple black box, and I'm happy. 16:9. It works.
Another thing, Panospinay was very... He very much pointed out that the Xbox team worked on the GPU in this.
Yeah.
Like, he straight up went. Like, he was like, and the Xbox team worked on this. And you know how they know what to do with GPUs. And, like, he was just, like, all out.
Actually,
do they?
Dude.
I know. I know. That's what I'm saying, is that he went all out in bringing up Xbox. He went all out and bringing on Xbox when they talked about this GPU, and it makes it very interesting thinking about what they're going to do in the future.
Yeah,
I think anybody who thinks though that there's not going to be another Xbox should watch this event again, because Microsoft just spent an hour and 35 minutes showing all these different bunches of hardware. Like, even if they do change up the model of how often they make games consoles and iterate on them, they're still definitely going to have a box. Definitely going to have a box under the screen that you call a fucking Xbox. They're not, you know, they're far too involved in hardware to not do that. In possibly the product that they've got that makes most sense to make a piece of hardware. I mean, if you'd have said, like, I don't know, 10 years ago, hey, Microsoft made a tablet and a laptop, you'd have probably said, well, I mean. Would you have necessarily thought they needed to do that? Whereas if you just said they were going to be in games and have their own platform, but they weren't going to have a box under the telly, you think they're crazy?
There's nothing I can say except that Wicked Soul totally owned that guy. I mean, I banned him from the room, but Wicked...
I'm sorry, Steve.
Virgin nerd, shut up. Jesus, get a job. Losers, get laid.
Get laid.
Don't have a girlfriend. N-word.
And then Rickett said, we all have manly sex with each other. Happy face.
One of Tim's stalkers. Yeah, probably. Is that Tim Cat's other profile's Aztec MLG?
It
Tim.
Could be, man. All right.
I'm Thank sorry, you. Steve. I didn't even hear one thing.
It's Tim Cat.
Oh, I heard it. So, any more news besides the Windows
the
event?
No,
was...
that's it for news. We're done.
Yeah.
We're
there was movies. One thing from the event.
Oh, my God. What do you want, Steve? You're just wrong. You're wrong.
You're not going to like what I'm going to say. Okay. There was the HoloLens demo with the robot.
Yeah.
And I think that I didn't watch all of the event live. I think I woke up after about 45 minutes or something and thought I'd see what was going on. But I watched the video afterwards, and I watched this video. I thought, that looks kind of fun.
Wearable holograms!
But I thought, that looks kind of fun. I said, you know, also this thing reminds me of? This reminds me of all those Kinect demos that they showed us E3 like for like 4 different years, and pretty much none of them ever happened.
Yeah, but
well,
the
I
difference
tried
is
it.
This actually is happening.
I tried it.
I know, but I'm just saying That's what it's
good.
It's gonna do wonders for your libido when you.
And
look
to be
down,
fair, this thing works.
Like, oh my god, it's big now. It's so
to
amazing.
Be fair, like the reason you have that thing on your hand that tracks it and follows it, that's Kinect.
Yeah.
Like that's all the technology from the Kinect that went into this thing. Like it's, I agree with you. The Kinect, like all those demos, were way over the top. But this, I don't think it's over the top. I think the only over the top thing about this is them showing full screen. You know, you can see everything when the guy can't. But
not rushing this to market. Like
yeah.
So.
But how
you have
can
a small
you do
field
that
of view,
with a camera?
Yeah.
How can you do that with a camera though? Like you, like I don't understand how you would be able to show what he sees, unless you.
Put it
have like
a small
but even then, like there was yeah. a giant spider that came out, pretty much, or scorpion thing that started attacking yeah. him. With the field of view, you wouldn't even be able to see the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah, it was right up on his face.
Well, to be fair, yeah. if wearing glasses, I wouldn't be able to see the whole damn thing either.
Yeah,
just me wearing glasses. But I mean, it's
but it seemed all right. I mean, yeah.
Tim well, actually just, used the damn thing.
Tim,
so.
how was it?
I was excellent. I think it doesn't have a full view, but it's really impressive. I was very impressed.
Is it the future,
it.
Tim?
Yes, 100%. More than VR too, a lot more.
Did you learn to become a plumber?
No, I played that game, Project X-Ray.
Yeah, that's best.
And it's you go up against a wall and you go to the next wall and you go to the next wall and you go to the next wall. And then you it starts breaking through the wall, and it's pretty crazy. Like you shoot and you blow holes in the wall, and it actually looks like you're blowing a hole in the wall. It's like the field of view didn't bother me. You just follow where you need to look. So
now I asked you earlier off the podcast, but we were talking, is it like a piece of paper about 10 inches away from your face?
Yeah, I think that's a good way of describing it.
I think when consumers get it, it's going to be HoloLens Elite. I don't know if they're going to call it 2, but HoloLens 2 is what the consumers are most likely going to get, and it's probably going to have a larger field of view. I think they understand their strengths, and that's why they're not just throwing it out there.
No, but they're
It's going to have a stake in gaming, but I don't really think that it's going to be.
You got a price too, right?
It's going to be
that's
more
on the dev kit.
On the dev kit, right?
Yeah, it's $3,000.
On the dev kit, yeah.
But that's like at the same time, the PS4 dev kit's $2,500. It doesn't mean anything, so
right.
It could be any price. It's probably going to end up being about $1,000 for it, which
that's
is fair.
Not $1,000.
Yeah, $1,500.
That's a fair price because it's a complete computer on your head. So
I would say $1,500.
Yeah, no, but I'm going to put it this way: your phone with less technology in it costs about $700 off contract.
Yeah.
So you figure this is going to be your phone on your head that has Kinect controls. So it's going to be more advanced. That's going to cost you about $1,000.
And by the time they get the consumer version out, the technology they're using will be cheaper too.
Yeah. So who knows? I'm guessing 1,000 though.
Yeah.
Let's see. Moving on to no news. We're done with news. We're done with the event. We can talk about what we've been playing. I'm excited
myself.
To talk about what I've been playing. No, Jason, you've been holding back your emotions. You're not supposed to keep that in. All right. That's not cool. That's not cool.
Hey, I was just Tim made the noise first. Damn it!
I didn't make no noise.
That was me.
That noise earlier you made.
I was trying to mimic being sick. I'm not sure I did a very good job.
No, you didn't. All right. Well, let's move on, people. Let's move on. Vern, what have you been playing? What games?
Yeah, it's pretty boring. I mean, it's pretty busy the last week, so I didn't get a lot of game time in. So when I was playing, it was just doing typical daily stuff in Destiny as far as the daily missions and doing some Crucible, and then been playing some more Forza. I'm still working on trying to get through all those championships, so got a long way to go in that. And then I played a couple hours of Battlefront last night and a little bit more today, so I really don't have a whole lot to say on what I've been playing. Sorry.
No, it's no problem. How are you, Vern? Are you doing good? Doing solid.
Yeah, I'm good, man. Feeling good. I had my Oreos, so I'm happy.
Yeah, yeah. Steve Rules, steverules.com. How are you feeling, Steve?
I'm okay. I could be better. You know, it's upsetting me that you keep always telling me that I'm wrong. And
but you are.
And then I make great points and nobody's listening. And
I hear you, Steve. I hear you. And that's why when you're proven wrong, I go onto Twitter and I'm like, hey, Steve, check out this link. I was right.
Yeah, well, Steve Rules, Steve Knows, hashtags is differently.
Yeah, I know.
Steve Rules is wrong.com.
I'm buying wrong. The URL right now.
/com.
I quit.
What have you been playing? What have you finished, Steve?
I've 100%ed? I have actually 100%ed two games this week. Pumped BMX Plus, which I was playing with. The Wicked Soul was also playing it as well, which is from Curve Digital. It was a mobile game, 2D with a bike, and you do tricks and get scores and stuff. There's like 500 challenges, and I got the achievements on that. It was difficult, but I'm a pro, so it wasn't too difficult.
Quick question, Steve. Did you have to play with Wicked Soul to 100% it, or did you play with Wicked Soul because you wanted to play with Wicked Soul?
Well, we didn't play together. We were talking about it, and I did want to talk to him about it.
Okay.
So once I found he was playing it and we were talking and stuff, so it was good. It's a really good game. It's like $10 or something. I liked it. There was 100% Bridge Constructor, which is kind of fun, but I don't know. It wore on me a bit at the end. But I've also been playing. How have I been playing this week? I've been playing a lot of Banished on PC. I'm playing Crimson Land, which is out next week. I'm reviewing it, so that's kind of fun, but. Apart from that, nothing too exciting. I keep trying to play Game of Thrones episode 5. I mean, it works. I just start it. And I'm just like, and then I just end up leaving it on there for like 2 hours, and then I go and play something else. I'm not feeling it. I don't know why.
It's a good episode, man.
Is it? Yeah, I don't know. I think it's just because the Garrett stuff just bores the pants off me. Shit. But I should get it finished. The thing is, I've got 2 Borderlands episodes to go as well, so I should probably get on with that. But yeah, that's what I've been playing pretty much.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Jason. What have you been playing?
Ark.
How do you like it?
Survival Edition.
It's like coming to Xbox.
That's a dinosaur game.
Yeah.
It's like Pokemon mixed with Jurassic Park mixed with Space Engineers mixed with an open world RPG.
I'm sold.
Yeah, pretty much. That's why I bought it. It's like, wait, there's dinosaurs that you can tame, and then you can level them up how you want, and then you can go fight other dinosaurs, and there's T-Rexes and shit, and Spinosauruses, and giant turtles, all kinds of shit. Like, this game.
That sounds good.
It's really good. And it is coming to Xbox. So, it's awesome. You just jump in. You start off with, if you jump in a server, you start off with a survival. You choose what part of the island. You always start on the coast. And you start level 1. And you work your way up, unlocking things you can craft. So eventually you can have guns and a giant metal fortress. But when you start off, you got like a pickaxe and a thatched house and shit. So it's awesome. It's really a lot of fun. I highly recommend it. Especially if you're dinosaurs.
Did we cover Project Spark going free last week?
Yes.
Okay. I couldn't remember. All right.
But definitely check that out when it comes to Xbox One.
Yeah, we will. We will.
It's going to be a game preview title as well, so it might be launching perhaps sooner than I think.
It's a DirectX 12 game too, believe it or not. So, yeah.
It'll probably come in like December or January or something like that then.
Probably.
Tim, sir.
Well, I've been playing, I actually been fully entrenched in a Madden season. I highly recommend this Madden this year. I didn't think it was going to be this good, but it's an excellent job. You know, it's really realistic. I'm 7-5 with the Giants, so it's like real. I recommend it. Also been playing. I played Extreme. I talked about Extreme Exorcism. Don't buy that. That's horrible. I also played the Tomb Raider at the event. I played Tomb Raider, and I have to say, if you guys liked the last Tomb Raider, this is basically that, but the graphics a real big step up. Really looks nice.
I don't believe it, Tim.
No, it really is a good job here. So I played the whole thing. It's the same thing. There's a little difference here and there, but it's basically the same game. A lot better graphics, though. Really clean. And ran well.
Okay. Awesome. Anything else you've been playing?
I got NBA 2K, and I wasn't happy, but I have to play more with it. And I play Forza. You know, that's just a game I just play every, you know, I every just, yeah. No, I just always do that with them. I just play that. I just play once a week, you know. I pretty
get
much
your game. Fix.
Exactly. That game just never gets old. It's uh-huh. It has a lot of legs.
All right, well, I guess I'll finish this off. We me and Vern started playing Who Can Get the Fastest Download Speeds on Xbox Live the Game, trying to download Battlefront. That was very fun. It was very fun. I eventually switched over to a wire instead of being wireless. We did that. Played Battlefront. It's not really a game. It's more of a cinematic adventure of me hating on it. But, it's a game. Play it. Try it. EA Access. What else did I play? I played something else that I wanted to talk about. I'm blanking on it. I don't know. I played Halo. Halo's fucking great still. I want somebody else to play Halo with. I played some more Metal Gear, and I remembered why I stopped playing it. Because I am tired of the fucking game glitching, and then my character just keep walking 10 fucking feet, walking in a circle, while I'm in the middle of fucking combat, and my controller's disconnected until like 10 seconds later when it reconnects, and it's like, hey, you can start playing your game again. And then I go, fuck this game, and I turn it off.
Wait, you're getting controller disconnects now?
Well, only in Metal Gear. It's a glitch in Metal Gear.
Oh,
how did that game get a 10? That game does not deserve.
It's got so many technical difficulties. That glitch is awful.
You're talking about the one where when you're walking along and he'll just it with the right stick. It's like he just points you not like someone's just twirling around in a circle.
It takes all control away from you from the game. And it always happens to me, like, right when I'm trying to sneak around and, like, I'm trying to get around a corner and, like, three guards are watching and my character just keeps on walking because the game's like, well, you don't need to control your game no longer. And then I'm fucked. And then I get annoyed and I stop playing. But the rest of the game's awesome. But, yeah, that's really fucking annoying. And I'm waiting on that patch to finish it. Jason, did we talk about Heist? I think we did. Heist are fucking great. I was very disappointed by that last Heist.
Last Heist sucks.
Yes, it was awesome. We robbed a bank. It's what you expect, but there's like I wanted more.
You don't get enough money.
Yeah.
You just don't get enough money.
You don't get that ton of cash that you want, and you know. It's
I thought the last one, the first time you did the last mission, it'd give you like $1 million. Be like, fuck it. You went through all the heists. Here's $1 million. No, you get about average.
Yeah, you get about 100,000.
Like, what's even the point of the last one? You can do the other ones and get the same amount of money.
Yeah. I played Minecraft with Eric, because Eric has never played Minecraft really before. So me and Eric sat down, and he created a world, and he started understanding the joy of punching a tree with your fist. So, yeah, we spent like a good like hour doing that. And I don't think he'll ever pick it up again, but he got to experience it and see what it was about, which was... For you know, it's always cool to set somebody that's never checked out like a simple game like that. And
hey, Eric. Eric, what do you think of Minecraft?
Yeah, but yeah, he enjoyed it overall. I mean, I don't think he understood the complexity that is Minecraft. Like how deep the rabbit hole you can go with redstone, with all the different little elements to it and what you can do. So it kind of blew his mind there, but I don't think he'll ever really get into it like anybody else did. Battlefront, no. I think that's it for me. I don't think I've played anything else. Yeah, I bought Zombi. I know it's called Zombie, but I'm going to call it Zombi because there's no E in it. And I'm going to play it eventually because I bought a Wii U. I wanted to buy it and I never did. And I wanted to play it and never did. And now it's on Xbox, so I'm going to play it here. It's going to be great. That way I can chat with Vern at the same time.
It's very good.
Yeah. I'm excited to try it.
I was surprised by it.
Yeah. Did you play it on Xbox or on Wii U?
Yeah, I played it on Xbox. I was very surprised by it.
Yeah. Yeah, I hear nothing but good things. I want to play it. I'm going to play it. And it's going to happen. But that's it for me this week. I appreciate everybody for tuning in this week. You can write us at letters@xboxuncut.com. Please follow, subscribe. Yell at Tim or Timcat on Twitter because, you know, Timcat's just an asshole and he won't leave Tim alone. So,
a dick.
Yeah. I think that's going to do it. Anybody have anything else? Anything?
You suck.
Fuck Timcat.
Fuck Timcat.
Fuck who?
Timcat.
And Aztec. Fuck Timcat, alright.
And Aztec guy, whatever.
And Seaboat. Fuck that guy, too.
Seaboat.
And Mr. X Media. Anyone else that needs to fuck off what we're giving them?
Don Matrick.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
Steven Sinofsky. Fuck that guy, too.
And Phil Spencer. And anybody that works for Microsoft because PS4 is the best.
Yes.
Yeah.
Drive Club.
Drive
is
Club
the
for life. And that's going to be it for this crazy ass.
Report 1886 for the win.
That's a low blow.
If you like a drop. You know what's a low blow? Charging money for that game. Earning $60 for that game. That's a low blow. All right, guys. We're saying bye now.
Goodbye.
Yeah, I think so.
Bye.
Later. Drive Club's awesome.